Hello, welcome to this special event as part of Blue Dot's Weekend in Outer Space, presented in association with the Cosmic Shambles Network. I'm Robin Ince.
And I'm Brian Cox.
And it's wonderful when we work without a script, isn't it? It was I should have given you some kind of nod, or that it's your line, you're Brian Cox again today.
I don't think we should need to script that. We've done what? About a thousand monkey cage hours.
Well, that's what I was hoping. I was hoping the Pavlovian response to I'm Robin Ince is, and I'm Professor Brian Cox. Anyway, well, you can check out all the other events happening over this weekend as part of the Weekend in Outer Space, and that's just at discoverthebluedot.com. And you can also find out about all the ongoing live stream events and podcasts from the Cosmic Shambles Network, including our regular Sunday Science Q&As at cosmicshambles.com. Of course, this weekend we did we were the very first act, I think, at the very first Blue Dot, weren't we, Brian?
That was, when was that? 1960.
Yeah, it was. I remember we were introduced by Wavy Gravy. He said, careful, someone's been putting some bad physics around, you know, don't watch out for some of the physics. But no, it was about, I think, 5 years ago, 4 or 5 years ago. And we went on, we were followed by Public Service Broadcasting and then Underworld. That was a good night. Yeah, I think we had John Coulshaw. Charlotte Church was there as well.
That's right.
Yeah, that was fantastic. But anyway, so this weekend, of course, because of everything that is going on, people are not assembling in... Well, I was going to say they're not assembling in a field, but I suppose we're always assembling in some kind of field, aren't we, Brian?
That's a very interesting science joke that you've just made there. You're referring to the quantum fields which permeate the universe. So yes, in that sense... Well, actually, in a sense, it's not that we are... Because that assumes or implies that we're somehow separate from the fields, when of course we are of the fields. So
I love it when you sound like a hippie. Hey everyone, we're of the fields. We are both of the fields and of the field. This is going to be very multi-layered. Well, this is going to be a broadcast of a superposition.
You're primarily made of quarks and electrons. Well, actually entirely made of quarks and electrons. And there's only one electron field. There's an electron field in the universe, and part of it are the small localized vibrations that are called Robin Ince.
So you are all small localized vibrations at this moment. You are all in fields and of fields and by the field. So even though you may well be sat alone watching this and you were imagining that you were actually going to be in a field, you are still. So that's good, in a field and of the field. So anyway, yeah, Blue Dot is doing loads of stuff over the weekend, and they are trying to make sure there is still some kind of sensation of a festival. And today,
can I just say that you turned into essentially a professional DJ?
Yeah,
because you're doing that thing where you fill and you go, yes, and of course Blue Dot is on our weekend. You can see our stuff at cosmicshambles.com. And it's all extremely disconcerting to me, because of all the people I know are professional, I wouldn't have put you at the top of the list. But this
it's not the original me. It's a totally different program they're using for me this time. It's you know the way in this holographic universe, apparently they've swapped the projector now, and whatever two-dimensional reality is not the previous two-dimensional reality of me you saw before. Yeah. That's how it works, isn't it?
That's pretty roughly speaking, a reasonable explanation of the holographic principle.
But we are
We can't stay on topic.
No, because there is that's the trouble, isn't it? There's so many ideas, and each time you see that shiny thing, you think, "Oh, that's interesting. Let's go there." So this is meant to be a 45-minute conversation that's coming up, but it probably won't be. And it's fantastic for both of us, because we're going to be talking to Andrian, who is one of the reasons that Monkey Cage exists. One of the reasons, I would say, to some extent, that you took the journey you took as well into being a scientist is her work with Carl Sagan and Stephen Sota.
That's right. So when I was 11 years old, so it'd be 1979, 1980, Cosmos was broadcast, and it was and remains to this day a tremendous influence on me. It was the time when, I suppose, if you ever need that little bit of extra reassurance that you want to be an astronomer, which is what I wanted to be, there, and you're sat there and you're 11 years old, and for 13 weeks, every, I don't remember what night it was, Monday night or Tuesday night, for 13 weeks, you get an hour of what I still think is the finest science documentary ever made. And if you haven't seen it, by the way, it not only stands up today, but I say still, I think, retains that position. And the reason is, and I think you'll see this when we talk to Anne, is that Anne, Carl and Stephen had a strong conviction that science is not just about science. It's about culture. It's about our civilization. It is one of the necessary foundations for our civilization. And Cosmos was one of the first science documentaries I saw that didn't try to separate the science away from everything else that exists. And I think that it's a powerful, it's polemical, it's political, it's all the things that science should be.
And it does. And I remember, again, I was about the same age as you, despite all exterior evidence. And it is just that remarkable thing where every time I go back to it, and I think I probably watch it once every 2 years, I think, oh, it's time to watch Cosmos again. There's always something which still seems revelatory, even though I've heard it so many times before. That first real, I mean, I imagine perhaps for you as well, the first sense of the size of the universe is in watching Cosmos. It's like that, wow, that is, you know, that and reading Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
And the fact that you can have, you're allowed to have a sense of wonder. In fact, the cosmos demands a sense of wonder. And from that moment when the Vangelis soundtrack comes in, which I want to ask Anne about, actually, how did that happen? And then those first words that Carl Sagan utters on the clifftop, with the waves rolling in. And you can do it because you have a great Carl Sagan impression. So
Cosmos is everything there is, everything there was, and everything there ever will be. And it is. Now, that alone, that's a revelation, isn't it? It's a revelation to an 11-year-old.
Yeah.
So we're going to be talking to Anne about her work on the Golden Record, the vital, incredibly important work in science communication over the last, it's now over 40, nearly 50 years. And would have actually been in Macclesfield, or near Macclesfield, of course. This is the something that I imagine she'll make sure she can get near Macclesfield next year. I'm quite sure, been to Macclesfield before for Jodrell Bank, but she was going to be at Blue Dot, and now she is at this version of Blue Dot. Welcome to Virtual Macclesfield. Anne, thank you so much for joining us.
You are two of my favourite guys. I'm thrilled to be with you.
Now, we're going to start, because, of course, the festival is named after Pale Blue Dot. So we need to start off by talking. I mean, it seems such an intriguing thing that such an important photograph, such an important image had to be fought for. You know, now that, before we even get there, do you remember your first sensation when you saw that image?
Yes, I do. And of course, I'd be the first to admit that, our memories can't be entirely trusted, but this is the way I remember it. And that is Carl coming back with a hard copy of the picture and the two of us staring at it for a very, very long time. And, you know, for me, obviously for Carl, who had been fighting for this since 1981, and so for more than 10 years. And the response always was, well, what's the scientific value? It'll burn out the cameras. And of course, this was going to be the very last picture of, what, 10,000 pictures that Voyager 1 had taken, something on that order. And, you know, Carl, he's such a, in so many ways, he was so brilliant. But I think he understood that we needed to see a reflection of our true circumstances in the universe, not the Apollo frame-filling image, which was also a kind of cultural sea change for the world, but to see our world the way it really looks in the context of the solar system, let alone, you know, the infinitely greater cosmos. And it wasn't very long after that that Carl began writing his meditation on the Pale Blue Dot. And I stuck a few phrases in there. And I remember seeing the picture, and somehow in my movie memory, we cut to that moment in our living room when he's dictating his pale blue dot passage. And I'm, you know, suggesting a phrase here and there, but it was truly Carl. And what I love so much about it is that it's that moment, that intersection of science and civilization, of our spiritual awareness of who we really are and our true circumstances. You don't need an advanced degree to get it. It's such an indictment of the nationalist, the chauvinist, the polluter, the fossil fuel distributor. It's all right there in that tiny one pixel Earth. And, you know, I have a boundless number of reasons to be proud of Carl, but that's certainly up there in the top 10.
And your involvement on Voyager went back quite a long way before that, of course, because you curated the Golden Record. Could you talk a bit about that, how you became involved in the project, and specifically about the Golden Record, which is another example of something actually we just talked about in the introduction, which is the way that both you and Carl had this the insight to connect science with wider culture and with civilization and with politics. And as I just said in the introduction, I should say we recorded it before you came on, you said exactly what I just said I loved about Cosmos and your work, which is that is an important part of space exploration and science.
Absolutely. I think that our civilization was built on this foundational myth that if you partake of the fruit of the tree of knowledge, you will be damned. Your life will be ruined. And that's so often the depiction of the scientist, even now, although it's changed for the better. But it's always, you know, the alienated, messed up, the person who can't love, the person to whom all those spiritual experiences are foreclosed because they know too much somehow. And Carl was that perfect blend of both skepticism and wonder, never one at the expense of the other. He was tearing down the walls that siloed the different scientific disciplines. He was, you know, wildly interdisciplinary, but moreover, he was a true citizen, a small d Democrat, who really believed that science belongs to all of us, not just because it's our birthright, because all of these, you know, very ambitious scientific research programs are paid for the most part, by all of us, but also because you can't have a democratic society in which people are ignorant. You can't, and we are living through one of the most horrendous examples of that problem, that especially in a society that's totally dependent on science and high technology, our future depends on sharing that knowledge with the widest possible public. And, you know, Brian, as you know, you can be a really first-rate scientist and be very committed to doing your science. And yet, even now, when you go before the public, very often, you know, colleagues have a certain kind of resentment, which is the opposite of really of a rational response, which is, yes, go out and touch people with the splendor and the power and the joy of this knowledge so that it's as widely distributed as ever. And so, you know, I think Carl would largely have been Carl if I had never entered his life, because he was already on a trajectory. He was a true I hate to say humanist because it leaves out so many other species, but he was that kind of person. But I think, you know, the combination of the two of us was somehow a little bit greater than the sum of our parts, because I had certain passionate political beliefs. I came to science because of my love for the pre-Socratic philosophers who were materialists. I was fascinated, before I even knew Carl, with the invention of materialism, and in the sense of saying you can't use God did it or the gods did it as an explanation for nature. And here we are, probably more at odds with nature than at any time in the history of our species. And we have to get right with nature and a knowledge, a respect. I know of no better way to respect nature than the scientific method, which is looking to nature for the answers and not projecting our fears and desires.
Do you think there is something, as well as someone who was not a trained scientist? We were talking to Jane Goodall the other day, and Jane, of course, was not a trained scientist, and that's why she could go in to Gombe and she would do things in a way which, when she went back to the scientists, they would go, you've done it all wrong, despite the fact, of course, what she actually did was, and remains incredibly enlightening. Do you feel that being, working together, going, you are very passionate about science, but you haven't necessarily gone through some of the process that may well sometimes have knocked out your desire to go in certain directions? Do you think that meant when the two of you worked together, there was perhaps sometimes a tension which really helped illuminate?
Yes. Yes. Well, first of all, you know, my highest props to Jane Goodall, because, you know, until she came along, as you well know, the study of our non-human primate relatives was confined to those who were in prison. As if you would only study humans in a maximum security prison and think that you knew the full spectrum of human experience and behavior. So she is the great revolutionary who has taken her knowledge and used it in the interest of all of us in such a way that's so inspiring. For me, you know, the problem with me is that because I don't have scientific training, I very often come up against the vast pockets of ignorance in my own, in my own knowledge. And so part of me wishes I had done the math and, you know, stuck it out, even though it was a very intimidating course for women of that time. And I give the highest credit to the great female scientists who stuck it out, like, you know, Vera Rubin, who were willing to take that kind of abuse. But I think, you know, that my passion for science is also because, you know, I've never had to write a grant proposal, or I've never had to live in those academic circles and, you know, develop, you know, any kind of resentment. And so to me, it's just a feast of knowledge and ideas that I find more exciting than from virtually any other source.
Can I ask you about the Voyager specifically?
Yes,
you're talking about Pale Blue Dot. I thought it'd be interesting just to know the history of how you got involved with the project, because this is the most iconic spacecraft, I think, that's ever been launched. And we're still talking to both of them, which is a wonderful thing.
I know. We're still, I get on Twitter, you know, I get that little report every single week of, you know, Voyager 1 and Voyager 2. So how it came about was that Carl and I had worked together on one project previous to the Voyager record, and that was a Cosmos for Kids, which we were commissioned to work on by the Children's Television Workshop of Sesame Street fame. And unfortunately, it was one of those projects that never got produced. But in 1976, Carl and I had a chance to think together, and it was sublime. It was, you know, I always compare it to two sea mammals, you know, making their way through the ocean, you know, communicating almost wordlessly. And so when the Voyager record, you know, when Frank Drake and Carl began discussing the Voyager record, he knew of my passion for music, and not just European or Western American music, but for world music, which really wasn't yet, it didn't exist. You know, it was a very, go back to the 1970s, and it is a very, you know, a time of extreme cultural imperialism, where you really didn't know what was happening in the other countries of the world. And so naturally, Carl, who's only, who admitted to one chauvinism, only one, and that is, if you look, I think it's in The Dragons of Eden or one of his earliest books, if you look in the index under chauvinism, it's carbon. And so that was, you know, he admitted to being a carbon chauvinist about extraterrestrial life. I'm not sure which book it was. And so, of course, he was open to all these other cultures. And then a very dear friend of mine who was, who's, I consider to be a real expert on music, Jonathan Cott, he introduced me to Alan Lomax. And there was Alan Lomax's apartment in Manhattan. And it was a warren, like a rabbit warren of 50,000 discs of music. And he would just pop one on the machine. And he was responsible for a number of suggestions, candidates for the record. And my mind was completely blown. And so that's how it came about. And then I asked him if I could do a sound essay. Was that a crazy idea to use a microphone as a kind of camera to document the geological and biological and then technological sounds? And he said, yes. So I started making a list in this very house where I am right now, sitting at the same dining room table and writing down cricket song and all of these things that were so beautiful to me. And then a few weeks later, I said to him, is this a crazy idea, but is it conceivable that if I were to meditate for, let's say, an hour with, you know, my rapid eye movement, my EEG, my brain, my EKG, my heart, all of those sounds being recorded, and I meditated, would it be conceivable that these putative extraterrestrials of ours could decrypt what I was thinking? And by the way, it's only 43 years later, and we are so much closer to being able to do that when we were back then. And I remember it was a beautiful day, and Carl looked at me and said, a billion years is a long time, Annie, go do it, you know? And as I said many times, it was that meditation took place within 72 hours of these two humans working on this mythic project, a message to perhaps 5 billion with a B years from now, circumnavigating the Milky Way galaxy perhaps 8 or 12 times. And here we are, and it was just on that beautiful June 1st that after knowing each other for years, working together, being alone together, you know, but both involved with other people and very old-fashioned, finally, telephone call, found that perfect piece of Chinese music, music from a continuous 2,500-year-old tradition. What arrogance for us who knew nothing about Chinese music to say that we could find that one piece to confer a kind of the closest thing to immortality that any of us are likely to touch. Found that piece of Chinese music, which had been the, you know, the real challenge throughout the project, and left a message for Carl in Tucson, and the rest is history. So I, you know, to me, the Voyager record is the best possible example of the marriage of our highest technology at the time, our science, our engineering, our mathematics, all functioning flawlessly, and also our culture, our feelings, what it is to be human, what it is to be a cricket, you know, on a summer night singing out, and what it was for our, some of our ancestors. And so that's how I got to do it. And then that was, you know, then we got to do a lot more together for the next 20 years until his death. And all of it was, I just, my only problem is that my ability to retrieve the memories of every single minute we were together is so limited.
There is something on that golden record, because it's not merely a good introduction to Earth for extraterrestrials, it's a good introduction to Earth for terrestrials. Because I remember when we played it, but we did a, I think it was a tour about 10 years ago we did, Brian, and we decided to have our intro music for 45 minutes beforehand as they came into the auditorium was golden record. And you would see people sitting there going, what's this? What? And slowly becoming engaged. So I think that's a beautiful thing in it as well. You know, it's important for all of us to I think, keep returning to it. There's so much beauty, and looking at the photos as well.
Thank you, Robin. I am so happy you feel that way, because I am. People sometimes say to me, if you were making a golden record now, what would you put on it? And I always say, you know, it's for someone else to do that. We gave it everything we had, and we really put our best foot forward. And I look back on all of the music, and there's not a single wince, you know, there's not a single moment where you go, what was I thinking? And I have to say that I had the occasion to watch episode 2 from Cosmos, A Personal Voyage, the other day, in preparation for a talk. And I was so proud of us, because how many things that were done 41 years ago can you watch now and say, wow, you know, we trace the pathway of human evolution. And what is the end? What is the latest version of human evolution? It's a proud woman. You know, we did this wonderful sequence about medieval Japan, and all the actors are Japanese, and it's in Japan. And, you know, every single sequence was, I think, you know, really has withstood the test of time. Those values that we had then, you know, to see the world coming around to re-embrace them is so thrilling.
Can I just ask one more thing? Oh, go on. You've got the golden record.
I was just going to say, I was looking through the book, the golden record book. You know, the photographs on it, and they're also, as you say, it's interesting at the time. So we, in the late 1970s, it's a US project. It's in America in the late 1970s, and the idea that you manage to, I suppose, persuade NASA. Or to get enough freedom from NASA to have this genuine celebration of the world. I don't think it would happen now, actually. I think it would be, you'd be in the current climate, and in probably in any climate, I think for a single country to celebrate the entire world is quite an achievement, actually. And as I said, I was just looking through the pictures there. It's not centered on American culture at all. It's just centered on culture.
And that's so true. And I remember when we completed the record, which was also in June, that fabulous June, we did have two administrative people from NASA come to CBS Records in New York, where we were mastering the record, and to listen. And I remember, you know, they were wearing, you know, they had pocket protectors and kind of short sleeve shirts and crew cuts, and they came and saw us, and, you know, they literally, one of them said, pointed to me and said, "What is she doing here?" And Carl said, "Well, she's the director of the project." And they sort of looked at me like, how did that happen? And then when they started hearing, you know, the Japanese gamelan music and, you know, the Japanese shakuhachi and all of these different musical traditions, they were like, "What is that? Like, what is that?" And at the end, I remember one of them saying, "So those are the only American entries on the record? No Frank Sinatra, just, you know, blind Willie Johnson and Louis Armstrong and Chuck Berry? That's who you have on the record?" And we're like, "Yep, that's who." And Carl was, "Yep, that's it." And I think they were really appalled. And for in the immediate aftermath, NASA at that time was very, very different than it is now. And I think Carl was just a total thorn in their side. And they really kind of resented the record. And then, you know, even, I don't know, 5 or 10 years ago, I was at JPL and the public information officer took me aside and he said, "Do you know that even with the Mars landers and this and that, do you know that we get more calls about the Voyager record, more interest in the Voyager record than anything NASA has ever done?" And, you know, it's like, wow, that's just great.
Frank Sinatra must have been furious, though. I bet he had some guys break in and, like, screw one of his 7 inches on the side of Voyager.
There were some dead animals on my doorstep. But I just chose to shake it off, you know? No, not at all. But, yeah, I mean, it just really, it holds up. And that was the idea.
Can I ask just one thing? Is it true, that story about Johann Sebastian Bach, that there was a discussion of putting two pieces by him, and then Carl said, "I think that will be showing off"?
Actually, you know, I can never remember if that was Philip Morrison or, I don't, you know, there's some wonderful guy, maybe Leslie Fiedler, somebody said at the time, "Well, we could just send the works, the complete works of Johann Sebastian Bach, but that would be showing off." And so I think that's the origin of that story. And of course, that would have been not just showing off, but it wouldn't have been an adequate representation of the music of the world. And so we decided on just a two, and that was it. We wanted also, you know, we were thinking, there's a Peruvian wedding song, which was recorded by the great musicologist, John Cohen, who recently died, in the Andes. And it was a 10 or 11-year-old girl singing a cappella with just the sound of the Andes all around her. And so we wanted to have a child, our famous Chinese piece, Flowing Streams, was recorded by a 95-year-old virtuoso, the sort of Vladimir Horowitz of the stringed instrument called the chin. And he recorded this ancient piece of music called Flowing Streams, which a Chinese authority on Chinese music told me that it was one of the oldest pieces of Chinese music going back thousands of years. And it was about our relationship to the universe. And so this brilliant virtuoso was murdered soon after making this recording in the Cultural Revolution. And so we have this 95-year-old, you know, we tried to really make the demographic of everyone who was heard on the record to represent the complete spectrum of human experience as best we could.
Can I ask, how much since then How much have your thoughts changed on ideas of extraterrestrial life? Have things changed your sense of possibilities in that time?
Not really, because I feel that we're, you know, although we've made some great leaps in terms in the last 40 years, in terms of, you know, our discovery of all these exoplanets and the cataloging of them, which goes on. But, you know, I am not troubled at all by the Fermi paradox. And one of the reasons is I've had a very peripheral role in Project Breakthrough, which is the idea of sending a flotilla of 1,000 nanocraft. I carry one in my change purse. They're so tiny. And these nanocraft have all the capabilities of the Voyagers, but because they're these very small light sails, which we hope to launch in Earth orbit, because there's a, you know, it's a property of light that, you know, just these photons just glance off the light sail and propel it ever faster. And they're very lightweight. They can ultimately travel once you're out in the outer solar system. They ultimately travel a significant fraction of the speed of light. And they would overtake the Voyagers that have been traveling at roughly 35, 40,000 miles per hour for some 43 years. They would overtake them in 4 days. And yet they have all the capabilities that the Voyagers had. Well, once, you know, we hope at, you know, in the distant future to launch them to Proxima Centauri, the nearest star, which has planets. And the idea is they're so tiny that they would burn up in the atmosphere of any world of Proxima Centauri, like a shooting star. And so that gave me a sense of tremendous humility about thinking about the possibilities of extraterrestrial life. Because after all, if someone from a world of Proxima Centauri was to send the same kind of spacecraft to us, we would see it, if we saw it at all, as a shooting star. And that wouldn't, we wouldn't, you know, immediately say that we were being visited. Furthermore, it seems to me that we've only had radio for a little more than a century and a half. So for the 4.5 billion years that life was on Earth, before, let's say, 125 years ago, we could have been bombarded with radio signals and we would know nothing about it, because they would be totally invisible to us. And so my view is that if you have as many stars as we have in the galaxy and as many worlds, it seems to me that our intellectual development will not end with the techniques that we have now with radio, that there are other possible methods of communication that we just haven't tumbled to yet. And so when people say, well, why aren't they here? And, you know, I think if you're a spacefaring, an interstellar, even intergalactic spacefaring civilization, then first of all, you don't have to go anywhere to find lunch. You know, you probably solved the issue of lunch long before. And you probably also have a sense of all the different kinds of life that are possible. I mean, on my Insta feed, I just spend, you know, a half hour every day looking at insects and fish and birds that I've never seen before in total astonishment. So I, you know, my view about extraterrestrials are beautiful until proven ugly. And we are far too new to this and too young to arrive at any conclusions about the about life in the universe. Sorry.
Now, there are two other Cosmos series, of course, including Possible Worlds, which I haven't seen yet, which is just out.
Oh, I'm excited for you to see.
I can't wait to see it. I wanted to ask you about that. Two things, really. Why did you take that daunting challenge on of making another series and then another one after the iconic Cosmos from the late 70s? And I also wanted to ask you about what would have surprised Carl now, because there obviously have been tremendous discoveries. I wonder if you could pick out a few discoveries that you talk about in the new Cosmos that were just, you know, completely off your radar and unthinkable in the late 70s.
Well, as to why another Cosmos, why another two Cosmoses, it's because I felt that someone had to stand up for science, as you have done so brilliantly, that it was, especially in the United States, where, you know, I am a casualty of a kind of science teaching in the United States. And I feel that, what a tragedy, you know, and also just, you know, that it's had a calamitous effect on our culture, this alienation from science, this suspicion of science. And, you know, there are ways, science has known sin, there's no question. And it's not as if, you know, science is this flawless, perfect thing. It's human, and so naturally it's flawed. But to the extent that our, you know, my society in the United States has really not had the joy of apprehending aspects of nature, and having that as incorporated into a kind of a way of seeing, a way of thinking, a way of thinking logically, a way of a baloney detection kit, a way of knowing when you're being lied to. And so it seemed to me that if we could communicate that, the methodology of science, which is my favorite part of it, you know, this because we're such big liars. Well, we lie to each other. We lie to ourselves, and our leaders are just, you know, they lie chronically. And so how can you empower people if you have those political beliefs that you really believe in democracy? You've got to do that. And so that was the reason for the second Cosmos. And of course, I did it with enormous trepidation, the biggest possible shoes to walk in. But I was very lucky in that I had our original collaborator from the first season, Steve Soter, who's not only an astrophysicist, but one of the most learned people about many things to collaborate with. And you know, I went from network to network until I found Seth MacFarlane. And Seth had been so deeply, profoundly influenced by the first season of Cosmos that he was absolutely committed to me getting a hearing at Fox. Now, it sounds kind of strange, like a head snap, you know, why Fox? Well, I wanted Fox because that's the people I wanted to talk to, and I wanted to present, you know, the awesome power of the scientific perspective. And it was seen in over 180 countries around the world. And it was enough of an even commercial success that they were willing to give me another season. And this season, this third season, was inspired by a sense of guilt, really, of tremendous guilt. I now have granddaughters, and I look at them and I think, you know, what am I doing so that to prevent them from living in on a planet that we all would find completely intolerable? And so I was kind of searching my soul and thinking, you know, what gives me hope? Well, what gives me hope is the little bit that we do know about nature, through science, as well as some of the great heroes of science, who in several cases in this new season were willing to stand up in a time of such state terrorism and repression that they were even willing to die for science. And telling those stories, I think, are good for a couple of reasons. One is, you know, here we talk about Voyager and what an achievement. And yet, you know, nobody knows the names of the engineers who designed the mission trajectories with the kind of technology that comes from the mid-1970s to function so perfectly, so brilliantly, that we're talking 43 years later about how both spacecraft are still functioning, still teaching us, because not only do they give us the first reconnaissance of the outer solar system, but they showed us the very shape of the solar system as it moves through the galaxy. And they have they told us where the heliopause is, where the wind from the sun ends and the interstellar medium begins. And, you know, I just think if you have a culture where the only people that everybody knows who they are people who are really just famous for shopping, then things are going to get even worse. And so I want to tell those stories, but I also want to tell those stories of our ancestors who had their backs against the wall and who were able to endure hardships that we can not even really appreciate. They were so awesome. And they endured, they flourished, they were courageous. And now it's our turn, because this magnificent history of life on this planet, as we know it now, is in our hands. We are that link in the chain of generations, and now it's our turn to stand up and to face our circumstances unflinchingly, as science does.
It's interesting, because you've talked about breaking down the walls between disciplines, and I was rereading Shadows of Forgotten Ancestors today, and
I'm so happy.
It's such a lovely book, and it's actually a signed copy. Simon Singh, the lovely scientist Simon Singh, said, "I found something for you," and it's there's a line. I was talking to a science teacher friend of mine, and he was at a conference, and he was infuriated by the fact that when other science teachers were asked, "Why do we teach science?" they answered, "Because it's how things work." And he said, you know, this idea of the loss of story, and there's the quote that you open one of the chapters with from Schrodinger, which I think is so, who are we? The answer to this question is not only one of the tasks, but the task of science.
Yes.
And that seems to me to be so much of the drive of all of the projects you worked on, which is this connection, that these are not separate. This equation is an equation which is in you and part of you and part of your story.
Exactly. And I feel that with all of my heart, Robin. It's true. And, you know, it's not absolute truth, because we cannot, you know, we're not going to find that. But that's the great power of science, is that it knows it could be wrong. It admits that. It gives its highest prizes to the person who can prove it wrong. That's genius. That's an error-correcting mechanism, which I completely revere, and we need more of those error correcting mechanisms, because the whole tableau of history is so, what's tragic about it is that we don't have such error correcting mechanisms in other things that we do.
What do you think are the, because at the moment we almost feel, sometimes it feels like we're looking at a species divide, you know, Demon Haunted World, which was such an important book for me. And I go back to it and I think all of those lessons that are still unlearned, you know, when we watch people furious at the idea of having to wear a face mask just to pop into a shop in Florida. And that's about their own survival as well as, of course, other people's survival. Are the methods, how are all of you said, you know, using Fox to me seems like the right thing to find the people. How do we, manage to work out the way to find the route to those people who sometimes will initially be extremely aggressive in their reactions to some of the evidence-based thinking that's out there?
I think humility is at the heart of it. Humility. And I think back to one of the miracles that Carl performed. You know, this is going back 35 years, but there was a time in the 80s when creation science, you know, this fake science, a pseudoscience, was being promulgated. And, you know, there were various local school boards that wanted to teach creation science, you know, as equal time with evolution. And Carl went down, I think it was Alabama, to testify as a friend of the court. And the creation science expert who was testifying on the other side wrote to Carl a year later, very long handwritten letter in which he said, you know, it was the fact that you were so humble and kind when I asked you my questions that really disturbed me. And I had to think, because you were just so calm and so open to my questions. I had to do this self-examination, and I want you to know that I'm getting an education degree now so I can teach biology. And if you hadn't been so, so humble, I don't think that doorway would have opened for me. And I always think about that. You know, it's like, I think it's too often the people who try to present this view of the world are grinding another axe, are feeling a certain kind of satisfaction in being smarter than the people they're trying to change. And I think it's really, you have to have this profound respect for everyone and to be able to look them in the eye deeply and listen to what they're saying and understand their motivation. I think that's absolutely critical. Carl, in all the time that I knew him, I never heard him speak to impress anyone with how much he knew, only to communicate. And I think that's part of the secret, is being, is first of all, having that kind of feeling in your heart of goodwill, and that there's a way to connect with anyone if you're willing, if you're willing to open yourself up to that. I think that's really critical. And so, you know, I just, it's fun to make jokes at people's expense and, you know, to make them feel stupid, but I know that doesn't work with me. You know, it just doesn't help me understand something I don't understand.
Yeah, I think there's a thread that runs through all your work, which you touch upon there, which is optimism, which is a belief that there is not only something reachable in everybody, but actually there is a much better future reachable for all of us. So are you? But I've just said you're optimistic, but how optimistic are you? Because we're in a difficult position. We're speaking. We should have been live on stage in front of this beautiful telescope behind me, and we're not. Yeah, you've referred to the not only the pandemic, but climate change and the difficulty we have in politics at the moment. Do you see that the tide is beginning to change? And are you optimistic about not only the far future, but the next few years, the next 5 years, 10 years?
I am naturally optimistic. That's my bias. So I have to declare that. I mean, I think my kids think, you know, sometimes that I'm incorrigibly optimistic. But I have taken so much optimism this spring. You know, I've been, I was secluded for the quarantine from the first week in March till just a month ago. And now I'm only get to see, you know, the people who quarantined themselves in order for us to be together. And the demonstrations in the United States and in all over the world have given me tremendous hope, because it's almost, and the tearing down of those damn statues. The one, you know, that I saw that happened in England, which just filled me with joy, as well as Robert E. Lee and these other guys. It's really when, you know, there's always a period where people on one extreme side and the other have hold beliefs. But it's when the great middle becomes engaged and suddenly the scales fall from their eyes and we suddenly realize that something terrible has been maintained unconscionably for more than a century, something wicked, something wrong. When people of every description, can suddenly feel that, that gives me so much hope. I look at the demonstrations in the United States and, you know, they are for the most part leaderless. It's not as if some charismatic figure has come and through their charm and, you know, powers of persuasion have suddenly gotten people to do this. It was an internal process that took far too long. And of course, we're not home, but it was so widespread. And the demographic was all ages and everyone. That really tells me that we are ready to become who we have to become. In order, you know, because the problems of environmental depredation and injustice, they are intertwined. They are part of the same, selfishness and narcissism and short-sightedness. And the other reason I wanted to do Every Cosmos was to remind all of us of the timescales of science. Because to me, there is no form of social organization at this moment that internalizes those timescales and thinks of our actions in terms of 100 years from now, let alone 1,000 years from now, and what the consequences for our descendants and for the other species will be. That's what we need, and that's why tearing down that wall between science and society is so critical. Because if we thought in those timescales, we would be taking the very first giant step to becoming who we have to become in order to endure.
Thank you so much, Anne. I think we've I hope we're able to do this live one time as well. Next year, it will be a wonderful thing to do. So many more things to talk about, so many things that I hope everyone watching this will now go off. If you have not investigated some of the ideas with this, if you've not sat down and listened to the Golden Record, which you can do very easily, just go on the internet, you will find it. You're able to listen to it all. If you've not read Shadows of Forgotten Ancestors.
And seen, what is it now? Is it, would it be a 26, 39, 30 episodes of Cosmos? 39. Yes. Hours.
39th episode in Cosmos and a Cosmos book, of which I'm very proud, called Possible Worlds, which I wrote. And, just please, let's do this again. I really enjoyed this conversation. And I love the work that you both do, and really tremendous admiration.
But thank you. I just want to say thank you, Anne, because it's always, as you know, I'm such a huge fan. It's always a great pleasure to talk to you. So thank you.
Both of you. Be well.
Thank you very much for joining us today. Remember to check out all the other online events as part of Blue Dot's weekend in outer space at discovertheblue.com.
That's so professional. You'd be a professional again, as I said at the start. It's fantastic.
I had to conduct Discover myself because I went... .com. It's a double dot, man. It's a disaster. There'll be 5 takes on Radio 4. You know that's going to happen. I conduct myself. That's how Peter Marshall used to do it as well. And check out all the other live streams as well at Cosmic Shambles Network. That is
check out.
It's on the script. Hey everyone, and don't forget, if you like science, and I'll tell you what, here are a couple of guys who bloody love science. If you want to know more about stars and all that stuff, then you can just go to cosmicshambles.com. There we go. I even added the .com for you there, Brian. The full anyway, it's a new song by a band that I am very much enjoying at the moment. And I'll tell you what, they are ripping it up, and their name is Dare. I think they're going to be very, very big. Play Dare, Trent. See, I could have been there. That. I've woken up Oldham Radio. Now, this is a band that really are, in terms of the Oldham scene, they are shaking it up. Yeah. Anyway, yeah.
Cosmic Shambles. Live at the Hurricane Hurricane Snooker Club. Yeah. Live at the Hurricane Snooker Club tomorrow, Saturday night. First pint of Stella.
Do you remember when we walked past, when we drove past, going through Oldham, and there was like a really weird, dodgy-looking music venue, and you went, we should do that on our tour. And then the next day you went, I don't know why I said that, and it didn't get booked as part of the tour. O2, Hurricane Snooker Club. Hang on a minute, what's going on there? Anyway, yeah.
Did we commit to it?
Yeah, well, it would be an interesting... It's basically our Blues Brothers tour, isn't it, where we do the whole, all of cosmology behind chicken wire. So yeah, go and see our Sunday Science Q&A. It's at cosmicshambles.com, and I'll mention again, of course, discoverthebluedot.com as well. Bye bye.